come. Now is the time to worship. Come. Now is the time to give your heart. Come. Just as you are to worship. Come. Just as you are before your God. Come. And one day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Now is the time to worship. Come. Now is the time to give your heart. Come. Just as you are to worship. Come. Just as you are before your God. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. So come, now is the time to worship. It's the time to give your heart. Oh, come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God.
Myself, and if I 'cause only good things come from you. Though the mountains may be moved into the sea, though the ground beneath might crumble and give way, I can hear my Father singing over me. It's gonna be okay. It's gonna be okay. From beginning to the end, you're so close. You have never let me down, and you won't. In the valleys and the shadows, I know you're so close. You're so close. Though the mountains may be moved into the
God sent His Son. They called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He went and died to buy my pardon, an empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Yeah.
I'll cross the river. I'll fight life's final war with pain, and then as death gives way.
Make all The Brand Marks of Jesus from Galatians is the book that we're going from. And the reason for it is in chapter 6 and verse 17 of Galatians, it says, "For now on, let no one cause trouble for me, for I bear on my body the brand marks of Jesus." Paul wished to be so brand marked that nothing in this world or nobody in this world could cause him any trouble, because he was serving the Lord and moving along. And that's what we're striving for as Christians, to be to the point where things of this world do not test, they might test our faith, but they do not destroy our faith. A brand mark, you know, if you ever talked to anybody from out in Texas way, you know that a brand mark can be painful, but it does mark you as being owned by somebody. And we should be brand marked as being owned by Jesus. And if he's happy with us, who cares what anybody else thinks? If God be for us, who can be against us, right? So how can we get to that point of perfect peace in Jesus where nothing in this life can trouble us any longer? That's the series of sermons that we're in. And today we're at Galatians chapter 2, verses 11 through 21. A very famous verse is in the midst of this, and that's where I picked up the title, Crucified with Christ. So if you can and will, stand with me as we read God's word today. Galatians chapter 2, beginning with verse 11. But when Cephas came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face, because he stood condemned. For prior to the coming of certain men from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles. But when they came, he began to withdraw and hold himself aloof, fearing the party of the circumcision. The rest of the Jews joined him in hypocrisy, with the result that even Barnabas was carried away by their hypocrisy. But when I saw that they were not straightforward about the truth of the gospel, I said to Cephas in presence of all, "If you, being a Jew, live like the Gentiles and not like the Jews, how is it that you compel the Gentiles to live like Jews? We are Jews by nature and not sinners from among the Gentiles. Nevertheless, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but through faith in Christ Jesus, even we have believed in Christ Jesus, so that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by works of the law. Since by the works of the law, no flesh will be justified. But if, while seeking to be justified in Christ, we ourselves have also been found sinners, is Christ then a minister of sin? May it never be. For if I rebuild what I have once destroyed, I prove myself to be a transgressor. For through the law, I died to the law so that I might live to God. I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not nullify the grace of God, for if righteousness comes through the law, then Christ died needlessly." May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word. You may be seated today. That famous verse, Galatians 2:20. Somebody one time said 2:20, that's like electricity, like an electric chair. So get in the electric chair, turn on the 2:20. I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. The idea of crucifixion has been glamorized, actually, in our day and age. But in that day and age, for somebody to say crucified was a terrible, terrible picture in a person's mind. Crucifixion was a method of capital punishment, particularly starting with the Persians and then the Seleucids, the Carthaginians, and of course, famously, the Romans. The Romans did so from the 6th century B.C. to the 4th century A.D. It wasn't until Constantine the Great, the Christian emperor, banned it as a source of capital punishment in honor of the fact that Jesus was crucified. And so he stopped it. But that's several hundred years that the Romans put it into practice very, very often. in verse 20, as we read, you find that Paul is impressing upon us that we need to die to self, crucified with Christ. In one sense, we could say that becoming a follower of Jesus is the death penalty. I don't know if you've ever thought about it that way. But Jesus said in the Gospels, if anyone, any person, any man would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his death penalty daily, and follow me. Take up your cross daily. Once again, a cross or crucifixion meant dying. If you are to follow Christ, if you are to make a decision for Christ, you have to die to self to let Christ live. Would I be wrong to say to you that according to the Scripture, many people that come into the churches every Sunday and sit there and listen have never become a true follower of Jesus Christ? Now, I won't go as far as to say what R.G. Lee, the great preacher of the 20th century, had to say when I went to listen to him when he was 91 years old. He said, I believe among Southern Baptists today that 90% are lost. That's because the Bible pulls no punches on this. If anybody's going to come after me and be my follower, you have to deny yourself and die to self. If we're going to be brand marked as followers of Jesus, some things must die. You hear me? This passage teaches us about that. First of all, let hypocrisy die. He says in verse 11, but when Cephas came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face because he stood condemned. For prior to the coming of certain men from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles. But when they came, he began to withdraw and hold himself aloof, fearing the party of the circumcision. The rest of the Jews joined him in the hypocrisy. He said even Barnabas joined him in hypocrisy. Now, let's remember what the discussion is here. The circumcised are those that say you had to first become a Jew, become a proselyte Jew if you were a Gentile, then you could be saved. In other words, you have to work your way into being saved. And it had already been decided in Jerusalem. It had already been agreed upon by Peter and James. They gave the right hand of fellowship that we talked about last week with the Gentile brethren. They agreed that no, nothing must be added to the gospel. It is salvation by faith in what Jesus Christ did and that alone. But let me define something for you today. What is hypocrisy? Simply stating, it's saying that you say you believe something, but you intentionally do something that is opposite of that. You follow what I'm saying? It's not like some would say it who like to criticize the church, and they define it that you have to be perfect. And if you're not perfect, you're a hypocrite. That's not what the word means. If you say you believe something and yet struggle to accomplish it, but you're trying to accomplish it, that's not hypocrisy. It's simply the struggle that every one of us has when we seek to do God's will in our life. It's just part of our walk with the Lord. What we're talking about in hypocrisy is your heart belief and your actions and what you're trying to do. For example, in the Olympics that many of you have been watching, you would not say that an athlete is a hypocrite just because they tried to get the gold medal and they didn't get it. They were trying to get the gold medal. That's not hypocrisy. So let me define it, because a lot of people accuse the church of being hypocrites simply because they struggle in their day-to-day life. But if in their heart they're trying to do what God wants them to do and just falling short, that's not hypocrisy. That's just weakness of the flesh. And we're trying to get past that, and we're working on it. In this case, Peter knew and stated that God is no respecter of persons. And he had given his right hand to fellowship with the Gentile brethren. And yet here in this case, he was intentionally doing the opposite. He was practicing hypocrisy on purpose, doing the opposite of what he knew to be true. Hypocrisy must die. We have too many Christians that intentionally do what they know God does not want them to do. And that is hypocrisy. We should all be striving to be what God wants us to be in every case. And then if we fall short, God can pick us back up, dust us off, and say, give it another try, and we can keep on learning. Another thing that it shows here that must die in Christianity today is this idea of justification by works. Indeed, it's not just in Christianity, it's in all the world religions. Every one of the world religions, except true Christianity as taught by the New Testament, believe you can work your way into heaven. Whether it's you balance the scales out, you do more good works, karma. Don't use the word karma, that's Hinduism. Okay, no, God judges based upon his word, not based upon your good works or bad works, and nobody gets karma. As a matter of fact, people will get what's coming to them in the judgment, but that doesn't necessarily mean in life. You can be the most difficult rascal that's ever out there with no good motives whatsoever, and in this life look like you're doing pretty good, be rich and got cars and land and everything like that. Why does good things happen to bad people? I'll turn it the other way. You know, we ask the question, why do bad things happen to good people? Listen, because it's not based on karma. It's based on the Word of God. It's based on your relationship with Jesus Christ. You can do nothing. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There's none righteous, no, not one. It doesn't matter what you do. You can't work your way in. When you get to the end of time and judgment, the question's going to be, what have you done with Jesus? Not how much good you think you've done. Well, in verse 15, we are Jews by nature and not sinners from among the Gentiles. Nevertheless, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ, even we, speaking of Jews, have believed in Jesus Christ. Even those that had the law have believed in Jesus Christ. He's reminding them of that. Works are something that we can do ourselves, and keeping of the law is what the Jews could do themselves. But the fact of the matter is, no one had ever kept the law. And if they think they had, Jesus blew it out of the water in the Sermon on the Mount when he said, you've heard it said of old, thou shalt not commit adultery, but I say if you look on a woman in lust after her, you already did it. And he goes through several other things that they'd heard of old. In other words, the law is a tutor that teaches us something. Paul will say in another place, it teaches us something, and that is that we're sinners. That's what it teaches us. So the Jews were caught up in the law. That included the Torah, the first five books of the Old Testament, and the Mishnah, the rabbinical law that had 800 and some laws around the laws that are actually found in the Bible, the made-up laws, in other words. You know, we also make up our own religious laws. Did you know that? As a matter of fact, most of the time people that get into fusses in church, they get into fusses about the law that's not in the Bible. Like what color is the carpet? How long the service went? What kind of songs you sang? You know, how's your hair? What's your hair look like? You know, how'd you dress today? All those laws we make up that aren't even in the Bible. Right? So we can understand what the Jews did there, right? We make them up. And here's the thing. You've probably heard this yourself of somebody in the old days. I don't hear it as much anymore, but it used to be that at the end of a prayer, somebody praying and say, and Lord, if there's anything that I've done that I can't remember that I did and it was wrong, will you please forgive me about that? You remember hearing that a lot in people's prayers? Well, all that does is show that everybody understands you can't keep the law, even the laws you made up. You're going to break them. Everybody breaks the law of God. This statement shows that. That is what he means when he says this. For through the law, I died to the law. Do you understand what he's saying? Through the law, I died to the law. Paul was a rabbi, trained by the best rabbi of the day. He was an up-and-comer in the Pharisee faith. And yet he said, look, when I looked at the law, I understand and know I've disobeyed the law and I've got to die because of the law. He says that for through the law, I died to the law so that I might live to God. It is that understanding that we are sinners. The Roman 3:23, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, is that which springboard us to Romans 6:23, that the wages of that sin is death. That's what Paul's saying. By the law, I died, right? The wages of sin is death, but then that pushes us to the good news that it is the gift of God, of eternal life, that is the good news through Christ. So he's saying that the law is what drove me to understand that I needed grace. Nobody should ask for justice, should we? I don't want justice, I want mercy. And I want grace. I want unmerited favor. And what that shows me is I know that justification cannot ever save me. And people need to understand that. Just recently in our Gospel to Every Home, I had a conversation with a person that basically said, I've got to get to this point in which I feel like I'm good enough to be saved. I've watched people be saved in the past and I saw them falter and fail, and I don't want to be that way. I want to make sure that I'm right and I do the right things before I make that profession of faith. Well, let me tell you something. That's trying to do justification by works. If you were good enough, if anybody was good enough to make it into heaven on their own, then tell me something. What's the cross for? What's the purpose? Why? If you could do it on your own, if you could make your own karma, if you could come out on the good side of the yin and yang, if you could go through enough lives to finally make it to nirvana, right? Or if you could be like the Islamic man that I witnessed to in front of the gates of the shopping center or marketplace in Izmir, Turkey. He said, I believe that if I do good things, if I do not beat my wife, if I do not beat stray animals, he actually said that, dogs and cats, then I believe that when I get there, God will say, you're a good person, come on in. Unfortunately, I had to share the bad news with him before you could share the good news. And the bad news is this: how many sins does it take to make you a sinner? One. How many murders does it take to make you a murderer? How many lies does it take to make you a liar? One. You know what the payment for that one thing is? Death. Paul says, the law taught me that I'm going to die. And he means eternal death, separation from God. And this is the truth. If you've been somehow thinking, yeah, I've done some bad things in my life, but I've also done some good ones, and maybe I'll pile up a few more good ones and I'll make it through. No! One disobedience. One time when God said, do this, and you said, no, I won't. One time when God said, don't do that, and you said, yes, I will. You're a dead person walking. Right then and there. And the truth is, all have done that. So something that must die is this justification by works. Let it die. You didn't save yourself, and you're not going to keep yourself. God has done it by his grace and mercy. And when you put your faith and trust in him for real, and that is dying to self, then you are kept by his mercy. And he who started the good work will be faithful to complete it in the day of the Lord. Another thing that must die, the hardest one of all, self must die. You see it again on the screen, one of the most famous verses in the New Testament. I've been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Let me put it this way. The intent in being a follower of Christ is that everything you do and everything you say must originate from Jesus. You say, that's a hard task. Yes, it is. That's why I said this is hard. It's not easy. As a matter of fact, you can't do it if it isn't for the residing power of the Holy Spirit in your heart and life. As we let go, we let God. That's why Paul says, "In my weakness, I'll glory in my weakness, because when I'm weak, then I'm strong." It is when we give up, that's why it must be attached to righteousness by works. Doesn't work. It is letting go and letting God work in our heart and life that teaches us that I have to die to self. The more you struggle to do what God wants you to do rather than letting Him work in your heart and life to do what He wants to do in your life, the more trouble you have. You got to release self. Paul said that he had died and he no longer lived. It's Christ that was living in him. He says that the way to accomplish this is by faith. You notice that? I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. What is faith? Faith, simply spoken, is absolute trust. I say this over and over again anytime I talk about faith because there's so much misunderstanding about faith. Faith is not a magic word. Faith is not an abracadabra. It's a common word. And in the New Testament, it means when you put your faith in Christ, that means you put your absolute trust in Christ. Now, what does that mean? Well, if you use it as a magic word, well, I've got seed faith. I've got this, you know, because I got faith, I get a Cadillac, you know, that kind of stuff. Baloney. Where in the Bible does it say God wants you to have a Cadillac? A horse, even. How about a donkey? No. These feel-good preachers sometimes talk about health and wealth all the time. But Jesus talked about denial of self. He didn't talk about wealth and health. He talked about something more important than those things. You see, you can't take those with you, but you can take faith in God with you. Faith is absolute trust. So what does that mean? That means if I read it in His Word, I absolutely believe it, and I'm going to do it. Is that simple enough for you? That's faith. Romans teaches us, whatever is not of faith is sin. Go look that up. Of meaning the nature of it, what it's made out of. If there's something in your life that you can't connect to absolute trust in God and His Word, then it's not of faith. It's not made out of faith, right? And then if it's not made out of faith, then if you do it, then it's sin. That's why I say to you young people and adults, when in doubt, don't. You say, I'm not sure whether God want me to do that or not, then you better not do it. Because if you're not sure, you can't do it by faith. And if you do it anyway, then it is sin. God wants you to wait until you know. I'm going to do this because I know it's God's will. Well, somebody say, well, I'll never be doing anything. Baloney, read this Bible. There's enough in here for you to do to spend the rest of your life on. You don't have to look for anything else. You know, young people, how far does this go? To everything. To everything we do in word or in deed is all to the glory of God. Right? What school should I go to? What do you think God's saying to you? Well, mom and dad are saying, hey, I got news for you. Mom and dad are second to Jesus. You know, I feel God's called me to be a missionary. But my family wants me to be a doctor. Jesus takes precedent. They'll get along with it later. Believe you me, I've been through that. Brenda has too. Not everybody's going to understand. We got to die to self to let Christ live. You can't stand as a person and say that you're brand marked without faith. How can you be brandmarked, identified as belonging to Jesus, where nothing can bother you unless you have enough faith to do what he's asked you to do in everything in life? You've heard it say, this before. God doesn't call everybody to be pastors. God doesn't call everybody to be missionaries. But he calls everybody to preach the word, and he calls everybody to be missionaries reaching out to the lost, right? Not everybody's called to a vocation of ministry. But let's say you are called to be a doctor. Understand that you're called to be a doctor, and you use it for the glory of God. You're a doctor for Christ. Like Bill Wallace, the great missionary of the past, was a medical doctor down in Knoxville, Tennessee. And when he felt the call to go to missions to China to be a medical missionary, the guy who he was working with in his practice, who was about to retire, said, "I was going to give you my practice. You'd be rich beyond what you could imagine." And Bill Wallace said, "I can't do that. I'm called to be a missionary in China and to use my talent as a doctor there." And as he was walking away, the other doctor said to Bill Wallace, "Bill Wallace, you're a fool." And he turned and said, "Yes, a fool for Christ's sake. If you're going to be a fool, be one for Christ." Listen, it doesn't matter what the world says. You're supposed to die to self. Self must die if we are to be what God would have us to be. Well, as Jody and the guys come and we prepare to close our service today, I'm going to look through some questions here with you. Only you can answer these questions. I can't, right? Have you been pretending to be a follower of Christ? Notice the verse that's up there, the last verse we read. He says, "I do not nullify the grace of God. For if righteousness comes through the law, then Christ died needlessly." Paul said, I do not want to nullify the grace of God. These things that we talked about today from this passage that must die, if you don't let them die, you are nullifying the grace of God. Now, I don't think Paul was saying that Peter was lost again. He believed that in the eternal security of those, and he knew Peter had given his heart and life to Jesus. As a matter of fact, he goes on to spend the rest of his life serving the Lord and was crucified upside down because he didn't want to be crucified the same way that Jesus was. He's not talking about the salvation. Paul's not saying that if I don't let these things die in my life, or if Peter doesn't let them die in his life, or Barnabas in his life, that they're going to be lost and go to hell. That's not what he's talking about. He's talking about, I have received the grace of God through the death of Jesus Christ on the cross, the one who loved me and gave himself for me. How in the world can I walk away from that grace? How in the world can I walk away from that and not let these things die in my life? Because when I do, I'm nullifying the grace of God both in my life and my witness to everybody else. I don't want to do that. So these are important questions for me and for you and everybody else listening in today. Have you been pretending to be a follower of Christ? You need to let that hypocrisy die. It doesn't hurt anybody more than you, because you're the one who's still lost. Have you been relying upon church membership or your own good works or anything else that you think you can do to make it into heaven? You need to let those works die today and receive the grace of God, the one who died for your sins. Have you been living for yourself? This is a problem of a lot of church members and Christians in America and around the world. Have you been living for yourself instead of living for Christ? Hear again what Paul said, "I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, but not me living. It's Christ that lives in me." Have you been living for yourself? Then you need to die to self. Let Christ take up his place as ruler of your life. You see, all these things can nullify the grace of God. They can do away with the very purpose he saved you. You know, when you are saved, you're a saint, right? You remember from Ephesians? You're either a saint or an ain't. Because saint means set apart, but it means more than that. It means set apart for special service to God. And when you get saved, he sets you apart. He makes you holy. He gives you his righteousness. He sets you apart to do something for him, to let him have control of your life. And when you don't do that, and you let self live, or your own personal works live, or your hypocrisy live, then you're nullifying all that. You're being disqualified. I watched in the 100-meter race in the Olympics, a young man who probably worked for years to be there step out too quick on the blocks. And they came and bring the red card. Disqualified. All the work he had done nullified by that one act. Don't let these things that should die in your life cause grace to be nullified. I'm not talking about being lost to go into hell. I'm talking about the very purpose that God has for you being destroyed. All the joy and pleasure and good things that he has for you. Just to remind you once again, all through the Bible, obedience brings blessings. Disobedience brings curses. Well, today, whether you're a follower of Jesus Christ or you've just been pretending and you need to become a follower of Jesus Christ, either way, we're going to give you an invitation. And Brother Josh and Eugene will be down here in the front. And we invite you to come to give your life to Jesus. Come and once again, get rid of self if you need to do that, Christians and believers, so that you might fully practice the grace of God in your heart and life, whatever it might be, as we stand and sing, "Have Thine Own Way, Lord."
Oh,
you're a guest with us today, stop by the Welcome Center, pick up a gift. If you have any questions about how to become a member at Allen Baptist Church or to serve here, there'll be somebody there at the Welcome Center to help you with that as well. Church members, tonight, 6 o'clock business meeting. Come on back out and see what's going on in the church. The guys are going to send us out today.